Well, long time no see. You know, we spend a lot of time talking about specific cocktails on this show, but we don't necessarily have a great opportunity to talk about the ingredients that make them so good with great credence every single time. That's why today, with the help of McMann and Tate Cocktail Company, I'm going to be excited to tell you about bitters, what they are, the history of bitters, and test a couple of varietals for McMann and Tate Cocktail Company, who graciously sponsored this episode. So, bitters, what are they, how do you use them, and a great new variety on the market on today's episode of Mike's Hard Reviews. Roll that intro. Hey there, hi there, ho there, and hello, welcome back to Mike's Hard Reviews. My name is Mike, I'm a bartender in the tasting room at Green Door Distilling Company here in Kalamazoo, and today we're going to be talking about bitters, and we're going to be doing so with the help of McMann and Tate Cocktail Company. Before we dive into it, I want to give a huge thank you to McMann and Tate Cocktail Company for sponsoring this video and sending me free samples of their bitters to try for you guys. McMann and Tate Cocktail Company is a North American startup that features cocktail accoutrements of all kinds, ranging from bitters to salt rims. Everything that they make is intended to be functional with nearly any kind of spirit that you're going to be mixing with, and their wide varieties, especially of bitters, are going to give you great creativity when it comes to making your own cocktails, either at your home bars or on the job. Currently, McMann and Tate is producing 9 different varieties of bitters, including interesting specialties like root beer and lavender, 4 different kinds of dried fruit garnishes, and 3 different varieties of salt rims that give your drink just that little bit of edge. You can either click the link in the description down below or scan the QR code coming up on your screen right now, or if I can, I'll put a little link in the corner up there to check out their full supply of items. Tell them I sent you and that I said thank you. Thank you, McMann and Tate, I appreciate it. So, McMann and Tate sent me a variety of their bitters to try, and this gives me a really great opportunity to talk about what exactly bitters are in general. So, let's set aside these samples and talk more about the general idea of what bitters are. So, bitters, cocktail bitters, however you might want to phrase it, are essentially very potent, strongly flavored alcoholic tinctures that are used as an ingredient in cocktails to give additional context to flavors provided by spirits, syrups, liqueurs, and other ingredients. Funnily enough, they actually have a really long history and have changed form significantly over the past several millennia. Some of the earliest roots for bitters come from the Egyptian societies in the Middle East, where medicinal herbs were steeped into wine and used as prophylactics or stomach remedies, which, funnily enough, is actually a thing that persists throughout all of history. That's some of the earliest records of what I would refer to as proto-bitters, because we're not looking at a distilled spirit that has been steeped and macerated with herbs, botanicals, and spices. That doesn't come about until the Middle Ages, when both the popularity of distillation and the Renaissance-era interest in pharmacology come together to create more common, modern forms of bitters like what we would see today. While back then they were used as remedies for various diseases or things, or even as far back as the 1920s when Prohibition was a thing, and that's how items like Angostura, Bundaberg, and Malort even were sold, nowadays we understand that there's not really any medicinal value to them, they just taste really good. So we use them as ingredients in cocktails to sort of give additional accent to other flavors. Think of it like the salt and pepper of the cocktail world. In general, bitters is going to fall into one of 4 overarching categories with a couple of subspecies therein. The first is aromatic, which features things like Bundaberg or Angostura. The next is herbal botanical, which is things like peychaudes. Then you have citrus or fruit, like this Fee Brothers orange bitters. And finally, specialty bitters like this Angostura cocoa bitters. In one way, shape, or form, bitters is going to fall into one of these 4 categories, and each one provides something different to the context that a cocktail's flavor becomes. Aromatic bitters feature things like roots and spices, and they generally have a lot of deep, bassy notes that play really well with aged spirits in particular. This is kind of the thing that things like old fashions and, I believe, the El Presidente function on. Peychaudes or other herbal and botanical bitters are a bit more on the high end. They sort of have flavors that play well with the kind of grassiness of some spirits. So things like gin or rye whiskeys in particular feature very well, and that's why this is the thing that goes into a Sazerac, for example. Citrus and fruit bitters are going to be a lot less common. These sort of appear as ways to add an additional contextual flavor to drinks without necessarily needing to add a full pour of another ice spirit or syrup or something. The most common way that I use things like orange bitters is as an accent in old fashions, or as a touch of additional citrus flavor to things like daiquiris when I don't have citrus peels to shake into them. Finally, specialty bitters. Specialty bitters are kind of the most fun that I like to work with in my bar. In general, these are flavors that are going to be a lot less common in overarching styles of cocktails. Things that are smoky, things that are chocolatey, coffee, desserty, things of that nature that don't necessarily have a specific place they belong, but can add a lot of cool, interesting uniqueness to cocktails that are otherwise missing it. I believe there is a Sam Ross original cocktail from Milk and Honey called a left-hand cocktail that features a cocoa mole bitters, so chipotle and coffee, and that is divine. These four types of cocktail bitters are the bread and butter for a mixologist working on new creations that need this really just potent touch of a single additional flavor to make the bouquet of flavors more expansive. And that is why I'm very excited to talk about today's sponsor, McMann and Tate's cocktail varieties, which I'm going to pull up right now. So McMann and Tate sent me five of the 9 varietals that they currently make for cocktail bitters, in no particular order: Wildly Aromatic, Moroccan Orange, Bing Cherry, Morning Coffee, and Cocoa Mole. The full 9 varietals are available on their website. The one that I was most excited to hopefully get was the Root Beer Bitters, but they didn't send that to me, so I'm just gonna have to try that myself at a later date. But I am more than excited to have received these and very grateful that they've given me this opportunity, because this is stuff that is new to market, and sort of introductory products like this are so cool to see and play with. So let's go ahead and give them a full proper review, starting with the actual product themselves. I want to say, to start off, I really do love the branding that McMann and Tate uses. This sort of 1950s, 60s, retro, high-tech sci-fi kind of look. I think it's really approachable, and it doesn't really reflect anything else that exists on the market. People tend to go further back to things like the 1920s Art Deco style if they're going to go for something specific like this. So something more contemporary looks really, really nice. I will say, I do have a nitpick right off the bat. I am not a huge fan of dropper bottles. None of these are open, so I'll set these aside to just to demonstrate this. I have this bottle of Bitterman's Buck Spice Ginger here, and the additional dexterity that it takes to get into a bottle of bitters like this with these droppers and to draw it up and use it, put it back. This is not my favorite thing to have to do. A cap, dash, cap situation is a lot faster, especially if you're working in a business environment. And while this is definitely meant more for the home mixologist, if it were to get into bars, I feel like a traditional dasher bottle is going to be a more approachable way to use them. That said, you could just buy your own bitters bottles and put this in them, so maybe this is all for naught. That said, the bottles themselves are actually super nice. They've got this really nice, really well-made transparent glass that I think is sourced here in America, actually, and is really nice because honestly, a lot of bitters bottles are opaque or have wide labels on them. Angostura is the worst offender for this. I use a lot of Angostura bitters. Sometimes I do full pours, and if I'm using it in small or large quantities, if the bottle's opaque, I don't know how much is left in it. So being able to actually see the bitters itself, know what it looks like, and know how much I have left means I can prepare for when I need to get more, or if I need to move it from one bottle to another, that kind of thing. While I really do like the style of the bitters bottles, I do think that the labels themselves could use a little bit of work. This sort of design that they're printing across the front looks really, really nice, but the colors they're choosing aren't the most eye-catching. These sort of muted brownish tones dominating the labels makes them not really stand out very well. And on top of that, a lot of them actually look kind of similar. The two combos that I had picked out that were like confuse-able if I was moving kind of quickly in the bar were the Morning Coffee and Cocoa Mole bitters. These two just kind of all browned out cup bottles don't necessarily read very well to me, you know, from reaching into a box full of bitters back here and trying to pull one out. I thought that that might be a little, you know, room for a little bit of improvement. And then in particular, actually, the Moroccan Orange and Wildly Aromatic, these look borderline identical. I feel like there could be a little bit of work done with the colors being used here to distinguish these. Fee Brothers does this really, really well because they've got their whole sort of paper-wrapped bottles approach, and then the color of the print on them changes based on what kind of bitters it is. That's really useful because now I know this is Fee Brothers and I know what flavor to expect when I look at the label because the color is so distinct. You have good branding and good shelf appeal, or utility, I suppose. Kind of a nitpick, but if I was working with these in a bar setting and they looked this similar, I would more likely than not inevitably probably grab the wrong one by mistake and make somebody a whole new cocktail they weren't anticipating and might not necessarily like. Outside of that though, these look absolutely fantastic. And the thing that I want to point out too is these labels are not just like kind of snazzy looking and unique compared to what you're going to get, you know, from most liquor stores. They actually also contain the ingredients for the bitters on them. This is a super rare thing because most bitters nowadays have proprietary blends, which is kind of a shame, but it makes sense too. Because most bitters blends are proprietary and they don't want to be replicated, they don't feature their ingredients anywhere on the label, but McMann and Tate actually, if you look here, does list everything included in these bitters. So you know what flavor profile to expect when you're working with it without necessarily having to know all of the deep complexities that are going into making it. So for example, this wildly aromatic features, it's an alcohol base with cranberries, orange peel, vanilla, gentian root, cherry bark, clove, cassia, which is a kind of cinnamon, cardamom, and anise. That's awesome. I know what goes into this and I know what to expect. Looking at that, I would know that this would be excellent in an old fashioned because a lot of these flavors play well with the naturally occurring similar notes you'd find in like a bourbon or a rye, and it adds the additional context of things like anise and cardamom, which I wouldn't expect, but would play very nicely with the wood aging on a spirit like that. Same with things like the coco mole. Alcohol, cacao, ancho chili, cinnamon, oregano, angelica, burdock, allspice, clove. That's great. This is information that is going to be really useful to people who want to play around with these, but need to know what they're dealing with to make the investment in the first place. And that's a super great way to get more people invested into home mixology like this. So overall, as a product on the shelf, I think it could use a little bit of work to make it kind of stand out a little bit. The thing that I thought would be most beneficial is to rework the colors on the bottles and then actually match the color on the bottle to the cap. I think that'd be kind of cool. Do like, you know, beige for this cocoa, yellow for the aromatic to sort of play off of what Angostura looks like, orange for orange, Bing cherry could be red. This coffee could be like a darker brown, you know, something a little bit more noticeable. That way you have a thing that catches your eye when you're looking at it in the liquor store and is also useful when it's stacked alongside other products that might look similar or might not be as distinguishable. So overall, solid B grading, I think, as a sort of product on the shelf, but these are bitters, they're flavoring agents. We need to know how they taste to know if they're worth using. So I'm going to set up an array of glasses here and we're going to give all of these a shot right now. Okay, so what I've done is set up 5 glasses, one for each variety of the bitters, with 3 dashes each and then a small pour of seltzer water. This is going to lengthen out the flavors and allow the bitters to sort of function like it would normally in a cocktail without the interference of other flavors sort of muting anything. Quick note, I want to say, having actually opened and now used these bitters bottles, I don't dislike these tops as much as I thought I would. The rubber for the actual like tip itself is really robust. And it actually, like, you get a good squeeze on it and it feels like this good tactile feedback from that. I actually like that a lot. That's a big problem with other bitters bottles, like the ones we use at Green Door, actually. We're a distillery, so we have to make our own alcohol for everything we serve, minus a couple of exceptions. And the bitters bottles we use have really weak rubber tops, and they're just not very fun to work with. These are way better. I actually quite like them a lot. And while the plastic on the top was kind of difficult, the serration on it wasn't very well pronounced, the barrier to entry is pretty low, actually. I think that this is pretty reasonable as far as quality goes. Anyway, that being said, we have all 5 of these laid out here. Morning coffee, wildly aromatic, coco mole, and then orange, and finally Bing cherry. I'm saving this one for last because they were very excited about this. I believe this is their newest varietal to the bitters lineup. Pouring these out, the coffee was easily the most immediately noticeable in my nose. The smell that came off of this was so strong, I was a little surprised. So we're gonna go back to back. I've got some more water as a palate cleanser. We're gonna taste each one of these and compare it to what the bottle says is in it. So first up is our morning coffee. This one says it has coffee, cacao, birch, vanilla, orange peel, and peppercorn. On the nose, definitely mostly cacao and vanilla. I don't get any of the peppercorn. Strike that, the coffee is there. Coffee and cacao are very, very close when they're sans sweetness, so. Oh, that's nice. That's actually pretty functional. That tastes like a nice dark roast. It has a kind of a nice, very neutral bitterness to it that's very welcoming and kind of warming without being spicy, like a good cup of coffee would be. I don't dislike that. I do get that little bit of vanilla in there. I'm missing the peppercorn. I feel like that might be something that comes out more in the essence of a spirit than it would in something like seltzer water. Next up, we have the Wildly Aromatic. This one has a noticeably different color. I was anticipating this to come out, you know, orange or something like it does in the bottle, but as a matter of fact, it came out basically clear. Despite that, it has a much more pronounced nose than the coffee did, with a more wide variety of flavors. As a reminder, this one was cranberries, orange peel, vanilla, gingin, cherry bark, clove, cassia, cardamom, and anise. Really nice wide variety there. Definitely get, actually, funnily enough, the cardamom, the cassia, and the cranberry, I think, the most. The orange is in there as well, but it's orange peel, so it has a more, like, dry note to it. Oh, that's nice. That doesn't taste like any other aromatic bitters I've had before. That is nice, though. It's very berry-forward. The cranberry is easily the most noticeable flavor in there, which is surprising because I would have anticipated it to be, you know, like the cardamom or the anise. Those seem like they'd be the most pronounced. But what that really tastes most like to me is like a spiced cranberry bitters, actually. Like a Thanksgiving bitters, almost. That's fun. It's fun, but I worry about how it would stand up in cocktails that traditionally call for aromatic bitters, like an old-fashioned. We'll examine that question in a little bit, but I'm thinking now, oh, that might not be exactly what I would anticipate from a cocktail like that, so we'll play that by ear. Next up, we have the Coco Mole. This one smells good, too. This one had a very pronounced nose, and I'm very anticipated to try it. Again, interesting color, came out very orange, which I was not necessarily expecting. As a reminder, this one was cacao, ancho chili, cinnamon, oregano, angelica, burdock, allspice, and clove. I don't know what burdock tastes like, but angelica I'm familiar with. It appears in some of the amaro we make at Green Door. So I am interested to see what this is like. On the nose, a lot of oregano on the nose. Oregano and cacao come through the loudest, I think. Allspice and clove are probably playing in the background there, but really the oregano is really, really loud. I do get the spices. I do get that clove and that allspice. The angelica is in there. That might be the cinnamon as well, actually. Funnily enough, the oregano kind of out, in this context anyway, outplays the cacao and ancho chili for me. The chili is not spicy either. Maybe it is. It might be like a slight contextual spiciness to it. Yeah, it's mostly oregano, which is surprising, but I do think that that's a cool way to do that. I imagine some of those more rich, dark flavors play better with spirits than they do a mineral water, but I'm a little surprised I'm not getting more of the chili or cacao. That oregano is really loud in there. I don't know what I would use that for. I was anticipating that this might go into a cocktail I'm working on right now myself, like an original that appears to be a worldwide original as well, surprised me. But I don't know if it would work in there, if I'm being entirely honest. So we'll have to experiment with this one later on. Next up we have Moroccan Orange. This one, as a reminder, was orange peel, cacao, burdock, allspice, cardamom, clove, and anise. I'm assuming cacao appears in all these because that's their primary bittering agent. And I will say, none of these strike me as being very, very bitter. They're not like Angostura, heavy gentian root bitterness. That really hasn't appeared crazy intensely thus far. I'm wondering if that's where that's coming from, and it's mostly to establish bitterness than anything else. But sometimes it does appear in the flavor as well, so maybe I'm just uninitiated. This one's pretty muted on the nose. The spices I think are coming through the most, probably the cardamom. But I am pleasantly surprised. That is very, very fresh, bright citrus orange peel forward. That's actually really, really nice. It actually tastes kind of like the pith of the orange as well. Not just the peel and like the oils, but the pith of the orange comes through, which is nice. I like that a lot. A lot of orange bitters can be kind of sweet. Fee Brothers has this problem. Fee Brothers is, like, as far as bitters go, I think generally considered to be a sweeter orange bitters than a more potent, sharp orange bitters. This has definitely got this kind of fun, like, just presence to it. I don't know how else to describe it. That's nice. I like that one a lot. And what's funny is the contextual bitterness, if that's where the cacao is, where the bitterness is coming from, it tastes kind of like orange and chocolate, which is a really great combination. And I think that those two are going to make a really unique presence for a cocktail that wouldn't otherwise be there. I like that a lot. That's a lot of fun. And then finally, we have the Bing Cherry Bitters. Now, if I'm not mistaken, this is actually the newest varietal of the bitters that they produce for McMann and Tate Cocktail Company. They sent me a whole press release on it from a couple months back. And honestly, I don't have a frame of reference for what Bing Cherry tastes like specifically, but I am interested to try it. This one features cherries, cacao, gentian, cherry bark, cassia, and cardamom. So kind of like a cinnamon, cherry, spicy kind of thing. Again, the cacao comes through really loudly. I wonder if being backed by gentian, cacao just becomes a really strong, like, aromatic component where you smell it really intensely. The cherry is lost on me specifically, but then again, cherries don't have a super potent flavor, or scent rather, when they're just kind of like in a thing. They're more of a flavoral component I found. So let's try it. Ooh, see that. That is the bitterness I'm looking for in bitters. The gentian root makes a huge, huge difference. That's nice. It's really barky. It's not like Fee Brothers cherry, which is like cherry fruit, sweet cherry fruit turned into bitters. This is more like cherry plant. It's more rustic. It doesn't really read like cherry per se, but it does. It does do something. I don't know how. It's weird. Yeah, it's more like cherry skins, cherry pits, the aroma of cherries, which is kind of subtle. So it comes through, but that bitterness and the intensity of it is really, really combating with it. So I'm thinking this is one that would play best with something for it to bounce off of that has more character than mineral water. Okay, this is informative. Of all of these, I think the ones that I think I show the most promise are probably the morning coffee and Bing Cherry. I think those two are probably going to be the most interesting in cocktails. The Wild Aromatic, I think, for me, is personally a little heavy on the cranberry note. I don't get that in most other forms of aromatic bitters. I don't just use Angostura either, which is very, very, like, clove, nutmeg, spicy forward. I also use Scrappy's Aromatic, which is like a replacement for Boker's or Bogert's bitters. This does not have that same kind of like berry forward intensity. It's more herbal and like caramelly. It's really different. Yeah, see, that's more like the spices that are playing nicely off of the cranberry in this, but that's not a note that they have in there. So I'm interested to see what that does. I do have ideas for these, but definitely the coffee and the cherry are the ones I'm most impressed by. So now that I have kind of a frame of reference for what these things are doing on their own, I want to see what they do contextually in cocktails. So I've lined up four different cocktails I want to make using a different kind of the bitters each time, and then three that use a different one, and one that uses two to see how they play together, that kind of thing. So let's give me a moment to reset, and then we will do that. So, first thing about the docket I want to play with is this Bing Cherry Bitters, because I'm actually really surprised by it and impressed by it, and I think it's going to be fun. They did send me some recipes to use this in. I'm going to take this a slightly different direction, because I had an idea on how to deconstruct something like a rum and coke with cherry into a stirred cocktail. So we're gonna make a cherry black Manhattan with rum. I promise this idea will make sense. For this, we're going to need just three things: our Bing Cherry Bitters, and then a bottle of Ramazzotti Amaro, and a blended white rum of your choice. I prefer Gunroom Two Ports, but Probitas would be the next best bet. So I'm gonna start with two dashes of our Bing Cherry Bitters, 1 ounce of our Ramazzotti Amaro. This is a very like cola nut forward Amaro, so I think it's gonna replicate the sort of flavors of like something like Coca-Cola very, very well. And then 2 ounces of our blended white rum. Quick whiff just to see. I actually do think I get it. Put some ice and then stir this down. As I would do for all of my stirred cocktails, I'm gonna crack two large cubes of ice into here. And then we'll stir that down for about 30 seconds. interesting. I'm gonna grab a tulip glass here. Maybe we'll just strain our cocktail into that. If I was serving this to somebody, I'd garnish that with a cocktail cherry, but because this is more for science than anything else, I'm going to just take a sip and we'll see how that played out. Cheers. You know, this might not be a perfect use for it, but I can tell it's there. No, that is good, actually, yes. It opens up on the kind of funkiness of the rum playing with the cola nut note a lot from the rum and then the Ramazzotti respectively. And those two things have this kind of nice synthesis where it's like, wow, really forwardy, proof, heavy-bodied cola and rum. That's really, really nice. But late arriving to that is this bitterness that is not coming from the Ramazzotti that carries this nice, deep stone fruit note. And it kind of slowly evolves into cherry skins and into this kind of cherry essence, a more natural cherry than what you might find in like a Fee Brothers cherry, which is a little bit more medicinal. I don't know if it is a perfect use for this bitters because it does feel a little stepped on by there already being a bittering agent in here, but the two are still playing together nicely. And that's kind of the reason why I chose to do this instead of a cocktail that they presented a recipe to me for. Because I think that playing with bitters is a good way to understand it and know which kind of bitters works where. This is a good thing for McMann and Tate, because it means that even when there are really heavy flavors, you know, funky rums and you know, heavy dark Amaros at play, we can still get their bitters in the mix, which is nice. I might go more bitters even, actually. Let me see. I'm curious to know what like two more dashes would do. A gentle stir to incorporate. Try that. Yeah. It's this additional middle note bitterness, whereas the Ramazzotti is a very bassy, like back of the tongue, acrid, rooty bitterness. This is this fruity, but like real fresh stone fruit fruity, more forward bitterness. And it really rounds out the flavor present there. I wouldn't say it's cherry, like cherry flavored, like you might expect, like from like a cherry Coke or a cherry soda or a medicinal cherry thing, but it is cherry and it's noticeable that it's in there despite being presented by two really, really heavy flavors. So, McMann and Tate, cherry bitters, that's a success. That's a great bitter varietal. I think that's really, really nice and would play maybe better with a less funky rum, but I could see that working in a whole bunch of different sort of places. And honestly, it might even stand up to citrus, which is a thing I wanted to test and that we're going to do right now. So we've examined how these bitters play up against other big, bold, rich flavors. The Bing Cherry was a success, and that was kind of where I was thinking it might not necessarily work best. But even as I'm talking now, that the bitters is actually evolving on my palate. It has a really nice, subtle, but long evolution, and it's really, really fun. However, I want to see if something like acid is going to cut that and make it not as effective at doing its job. I'm going to be doing that by testing the wildly aromatic bitters here in a cocktail called a horse feather, which is essentially a Kentucky mule that substitutes the lime for lemon and adds bitters into it to make like a nice chill long summer drink. So for that, you're going to need some lemon, ginger beer, and then a whiskey of your choosing. I want to present a solid challenge here, so I'm going to reach for something that is not only above base proof, but has like a really nice, really like familiar flavor, Evan Williams Black Label. And this is one that we can just build in the glass, so let's go ahead and get started. I'm going to do three dashes of our wildly aromatic bitters. I think a good horse feather really hedges on the impact of the bitters on the citrus and the whiskey simultaneously, with the ginger lengthening it out and kind of making it, you know, palate cleansing and like refreshing. So we'll see if three dashes is enough to really make this work. Gonna come behind that with a full ounce of lemon juice squeezed directly into the glass. Then we'll do 2 ounces of our bourbon, in this case, Evan Williams Black Label, though just about anything would work well here. Quick preliminary sniff. That smells like a horse feather, but I'm already from getting like a kind of interesting plasticky note. Proper technique, we're gonna crack our ginger beer and pour a small amount into the glass. And then we're gonna top that off with some ice. I would use some smaller ice for an application of this nature. Fill that glass on up. We'll then top that up with the, well, take the cap off first, dumbass. Top that up with our ginger beer. And there you have, ladies and gentlemen, a horse feather. You can garnish that with a lemon wheel, a lemon wedge, wouldn't be bad. I think mint, personally, is where I would go with it. So it looks kind of like bright, refreshing. You get that mint scent on the nose. We're gonna add a straw, give it a gentle stir, and then a sip. Cheers. Well, I'll be damned. That does work. The thing is, it's not like an Angostura horse feather. It's very different and more subtle. So we're dealing with a lot of loud flavors here. We're dealing with the really, you know, the intense richness of a bourbon. We've got that bright lemon juice in there. The ginger's bringing this spice to the palate and this carbonation. And that's something that has to be factored into the effectiveness of the bitters here. However, I'm finding that this aromatic bitters is actually doing a just fine job still modifying all of those flavors and presenting them in a cohesive way. I think it's playing a more backseat role than something like Angostura bitters would, and is presenting itself to the extent of, I'm here, but I'm gonna be chill. That is to say, I see how it is changing the flavor of all of the three other ingredients in the drink, but is not necessarily presenting its own flavor like Angostura would, which is not to the detriment of this bitters. Angostura is loud and bold and is presenting a flavor that works well with all three other flavors in this cocktail, but when it presents it that loudly, it becomes its own distinct flavor and only works because it plays well with the other three. Here, it plays so well, but it's not so loud, so that the cocktail feels more cohesive than it does volatile and bouncy and like ricocheting off of your taste buds. It's nice. It's really nice, actually. Yeah, honestly, I think the cranberry essence, the orange peel, the spices and the gentian, they're really subtle, but they actually do show up super, super well when they're bouncing off of a spirit. And even the acid, which I would normally think cuts through something rich like that, in a way that, while visually it doesn't look like it's there, is playing such an important role in your palate that it can't be ignored. So, wildly aromatic bitters, that is a success. That is a really nice success, actually. I might hang on to this one because I really do love a good horse feather, and I can't have the AC on while I film. So it's getting warm in here in front of these brand new stage lights I'm filming in front of. Man, that is good. Wow, goddamn. You, McMann and Tate, you guys are 2 for 2. Well, 2 for 0, I guess. You're winning. One of my point is, I'm not a sports person. I don't know how scores work. Stands up really well to citrus and is really, really noticeable. I'm wondering though, how potent these flavors can be when they're not stacked up against something so loud, and whether or not they'll still work with other companion flavors. So let's try that next in another stirred cocktail. So we've assessed how well these flavors can hold up against really bold, rich, loud players, and how well they can add nuance to things that would normally cut through a sharp, bitter edge like that. Now, I want to see how well these flavors are going to play with companion flavors when they are making an important change to how they play together. I'm going to do that with the Moroccan Orange bitters here, and then a Revolver, which is a cocktail that features whiskey, coffee liqueur, and orange bitters, which is one that I've actually never had before. So this is kind of a double up, I suppose. Normally, this is made with a bourbon. I'm going to use a Canadian, actually. This is the Black Velvet Reserve. I'm not a huge fan of this whiskey, but I think that it's a pretty fair player here for all of those like traditional flavors we're looking for. And then my coffee liqueur today is going to be Luxardo Espresso, for no reason other than it's the one that I have. In all honesty, never buy this thing, because it's got this dumbass pour spout on the top. I wanted to put a speed pourer in here, and I can't now, because, I don't know, Luxardo wanted to be unique, I guess. Anyway, let's build. I'm gonna start off with 2 dashes of our Moroccan orange bitters. I'm going to come behind that with our coffee liqueur. We're going to do just 1/2 ounce of this, nothing too crazy. And finally, 2 ounces of our whiskey, which would normally be a bourbon, but I think this Canadian is going to play nicely here and be a little bit more subtle. So we'll see how well that Moroccan stands out. Grab some ice to chill and dilute this. Just like last time, we're gonna do 2 cracked cubes. And then we will stir that down to chill and combine. To serve this, I'm gonna grab another tulip glass or another appropriately sized piece of stemware. A Nick and Nora would be really perfect here. Throw on our Hawthorne strainer and pour that in. Like I was saying before, this video is for science. So the glassware was not chosen very carefully, but at the very least it's in there. Normally you'd garnish this with a flamed orange peel. I'm gonna forgo that because this is for science. Let's give that a taste. Cheers. It's a nice drink, but I don't think I detect the bitters at all. There's a kind of interesting late arriving herbal note that is not from the whiskey or the coffee liqueur for sure. And that has to be the bitters, but it's definitely not the orange that's coming through sharply here. I think that this is not the right, well, hold on. So just like with the horse feather, there's a sort of, and even the cherry black Manhattan, this is a late arriving inclusion to the flavor palette. It's not orange. I would not describe it as being very citrusy, but I do think that it is there. Of the flavors in here, I think I'm probably getting probably the burdock the most. The burdock and the cardamom. There's this kind of unique barkiness to it that I don't know what else it could be in here, but it's definitely not the espresso or the bourbon or whiskey in here. I hate to say, I think it kind of fails. There's not a potent enough orange peel, orange pith essence here to really nail down that the bitters is making an important impact here. Just like with the cherry black Manhattan, though, I'm gonna throw a couple extra dashes in here and see what happens. See if that made an impact. Okay, so now it's a little bit more noticeable, but it's still not orange that's presenting the most. For whatever reason, the orange peel in this is not jumping out at me. It doesn't feel like it's the potent oil, the potent macerated ingredient that is standing up the strongest to the other ingredients. And despite the fact, and that's surprising because, I mean, there's cacao and orange peel in here and coffee, those 3 things go together perfectly, and yet somehow all of the other ingredients, like the anise, the cardamom, the allspice, even the cacao, that is all coming through more loudly than the orange peel is. Worryingly, I think that this is not a traditional enough orange essence flavor to function the same way like Angostura orange or Fee Brothers orange would. This is definitely going to be more for like, I think your martinis, your dry martinis where you're throwing a dash or two of orange bitters in there and then giving it that, you know, lemon zest across the top to wake it up. I think that is where this is gonna work best. But in more modern classic cocktails, I think this might not be the right pick. It's not bad at all. It's playing a role, and I think it makes a really interesting revolver. I'm saying that as a person who's never had a revolver before, but there's a definite complexity that it's giving to the drink that I wouldn't have anticipated, but I would not say is orange, which I think means I have to fail it. Moroccan orange, in terms of standing on its own against flavors that are complementary but quieter than others, funnily enough, a fail. I'm kind of disappointed. I didn't think I'd be saying that. Despite that though, it's definitely still there and you can detect it if you know what you're looking for. So I wonder how this is going to fare when we pair it with another McMann and Tate bitters and see if these bitters can stand together to make a classic still taste like a classic. Okay, so thus far we've looked mostly at the ideas behind sort of modern classic concepts and a single very, very much like levied against the bitters old school cocktail. I want to see if McMann and Tate's bitters will work together to make an old fashioned taste like an old fashioned. I have the Wildly Aromatic and the Moroccan Orange here. I'm gonna use both of those today to see if we can make a decent old-fashioned and see if they work together or if they sort of combat each other, because blends of bitters, like blends of spirits, are a great tool in a mixologist's pockets, but they have to be tools that can function together to be useful. I'm gonna have some bitters here. I've got the Moroccan and the orange. Some rich simple syrup. Remember kids, your simple syrup should be pourable sugar, not sweetened water. And I am going to cheat a little bit here. I just picked up this bottle of Jack Daniel's rye at the store today, and I'm going to see if this will play nicely, because it's a rye, which is a more traditional choice for a old fashioned. And I kind of want to, and I like a Jack Daniel's Old Fashioned, I'm not going to lie. I think a Jack Daniel's Old Fashioned is actually quite nice. So we're going to see if this works well. All right, let's build, because this camera's dying. Going to start with, let's say one dash. Yeah, like 1.5 dashes, more or less, of the Moroccan Orange. And I'm going to go 3 dashes of the Wildly Aromatic, because this is really the kind of bitters that an Old Fashioned really hedges its bets on. I'm gonna come behind that with 1/3 ounce of this rich simple syrup. And then finally 2 ounces of our whiskey, in this case, Jack Daniel's rye. Thing I never thought I'd have on the show. Old fashions are usually made in the glass, so I'm gonna go ahead and grab some ice and we'll get this stirred together. Take our ice and just drop that into our glass. Large format is better because it will melt and dilute the drink more slowly. And then we'll stir that for about 20 seconds, 30 seconds to combine. Normally, garnish, orange peel, fancy cocktail cherry. Science, we forgo. Let's go ahead and give this McMann and Tate Old Fashioned out of, funnily enough, my O'Connor's Irish Cream Liqueur glass. Found this at a thrift store one time, it had my name on it. I had to fucking buy it. Cheers. Oh. God damn it, that is, oh. Okay, let's pull these back up here because I want to note, I was initially very skeptical of the cranberry flavor in the Wildly Aromatic bitters. Even right now, standing here having tasted this, I'm like, I don't know about that. No, I get it. It's a really deep, rich, fruity flavor that normally you wouldn't necessarily find in like Angostura, which is what you would put into an old fashioned traditionally. However, that being said, it is so, so nice here against those rye spices. It is like giving this really nice, round, and approachable flavor to the cocktail that I do not think I have ever experienced this robustly in an old fashioned before. And this is really, really good, actually. This is dynamic and rich and interesting. It's almost kind of desserty in the way that the spice notes from these two bitters play with the sugar. I think that there's a lot of background players in these bitters that come out louder than their base flavors in their preparations. So it's a little bit difficult to say that somebody who gets served this would think it is an old fashioned. I think this is like drawing the line perfectly between an old fashioned and an improved whiskey cocktail, actually. There's a lot of extra shit happening in this glass. And it's awesome. It's really, really awesome. I think it tastes great. I think it's a phenomenal cocktail. But is it an old fashioned? I'm gonna say yes. I'm gonna say yes, and I'm gonna say that actually pretty confidently. I'm gonna say that with my motherfucking chest. Yeah. Those bitters are modifying that whiskey in ways that I wasn't anticipating and bringing a rye spice back with a little bit of fruitiness, and that sweetness is kind of pulling the two together and making it very approachable and diverse. It's got a nice long evolution. It is missing the bitterness that I would normally get from an old fashioned because of how sharply gentian root influenced Angostura bitters is, which I would normally use in a cocktail like this. But even though that is missing, I don't necessarily miss it per se. Subjectively, I think this is an excellent old fashioned. Genuinely. I think that this is a good old fashioned. And that means we have a resounding success from this combination of these two bitters. This is a great way to make it, I think, honestly, a crowd pleaser old fashioned, if anything, because it's not so intensely old school and like anachronistic the way an old fashioned is sort of intended to be. This is like a real, like, thoughtful approach to an old fashioned using a more modern ingredient that makes it taste like it's of this generation. It's weird. It's hard to describe. This feels more refined. It's got more character to it, and character in ways that you wouldn't expect, which I think is a hallmark of a lot of modern classic cocktails, like the Revolver and things before. This is a lot of fun. Yeah. Yeah, that's good. Really good. I might be editing this video very, very intoxicated. Congrats, McMann and Tate. That's a success on the old fashioned, which was honestly kind of like my hallmark end all be all. If you can't do this, you need to go back to the drawing board. This is way, way better than I anticipated. And I'm going to apologize, frankly, because wow. Wow. All right, so we've looked at every angle of this that we could so far. And I need to say, McMann and Tate, you guys have successfully created an array of bitters here that I think is really, really functional. But frankly, could use a little bit of fine tuning. I'm coming from this from maybe a slightly biased perspective. I work in the industry, in a distillery, no less. I work with people who understand spirits for a living. And I have, as thus, acquired maybe a perspective that is not necessarily, you know, to the layman you're selling this to. But I look at these and I go, these are awesome. These have uses that are numerous and varied, but they don't necessarily fit the ones that a layperson would lean to. Like the aromatic is really heavy on the cranberry, but it works really well in cocktails. However, the Moroccan orange, despite being more nuanced and interesting as a spirit, doesn't necessarily fit the use cases for that. I guess my overarching conclusion to this is, yeah, buy these bitters, but they're not quite at the notion of an industry standard yet. That is to say, I would see these in a bar and go, oh, okay, these mixologists have figured out what cocktails these work best in. They've taken the time to examine where these are best suited to be used, and as a result have put them into specific cocktails because they know it will work very, very well. Not necessarily that these are a perfect substitution for other cocktail bitters of the same type. For example, Bitterman's makes a Coco Mole bitters as well, and I think also a coffee bitter, a whole bunch of shit. And I would say theirs is probably a little bit more refined to the point where it can be used in any place that calls for Coco Mole bitters. It might be different from a different bitters in that same application, but it still reads the same way, similar enough to know it. That is what it is. Here, I think we've got some striations from expectation that are a lot of fun. A lot of fun. Very, very fun to play with. However, are not necessarily perfect for what the industry expects from a bitters company. And maybe that's the point. Maybe the point is to be a mover and shaker and fucking get out there and break the mold, you know? And I respect the fuck out of that. I was in a 3D forms class in college that was basically doing like physical media, like art. And the project said, just shellac the wood sculpture you're making. And I went, fuck that. I'm gonna like dye the wood and paint it and like make it look cool. And there was a guy who was an established artist who was like, that's what the fuck we're out here for. And he gave me a fucking high five. And that guy was cool as shit. I hope he's doing well. My point is that the whole point of the modern mixological industry post-cocktail renaissance is to push the limits of what this industry can do. I think this bitters is a perfect example of a company trying to do that. However, I think that these recipes require a little bit more fine-tuning to be more applicable to common uses to justify them being tried as opposed to other forms of bitters. Let me put it to you this way. If I were to line these bitters up, which ones would I still use in cocktails? The coco mole, frankly, I didn't test anything with it yet. I have my own cocktail I'm gonna be putting this into after this video is done and I've sobered up a little bit to see how it works. But frankly, I don't think this has the correct balance to it. I wouldn't use this. I would use bitterments. As a stand-in, I'm gonna use this Buck Spice bitters because I don't have their coco mole. The Bing Cherry, frankly, I think it is more interesting than most other cherry bitters on the market. And as a result, I'm gonna say I'm going to keep it. However, if somebody asked me for a cocktail that I thought cherry bitters would go well in, like they said, hey, make me something, come up with something for me, I might not necessarily reach for it. There are specific use cases for this that where I think it fares best, and it needs to be more fine-tuned and cherry fruit forward to justify using it in every context. So this is a win, but I'm gonna be a little bit tentative about it. The Wildly Aromatic. Okay, look, Angostura is really hard to beat. I'm going to say that Angostura is disqualified from this conversation because it is too common a bitters to suggest be a substitute for any other form of aromatic bitters. That said, absolute win. I think it's a lot of fun. I think it has a lot of legs to stand on. It's got very long legs to stand on. Not sponsored by the film, but I'm going to put it aside here for a joke I'm gonna make in the editing room. Is this even funny to you guys? Wildly Aromatic, that's a win. I think that's really interesting. The sort of stone fruit cranberry notes in there are really fun, and the additional complexity from the other ingredients are noticeable, distinct, and still functional in cocktails where you would expect aromatic bitters to be applied. Moroccan Orange. Ah, if there was a use case for a bitters that goes specifically into dry martinis, especially ones that are being served, you know, not dirty, you know, a traditional dry martini, I would say this is it. However, the problem is this does not necessarily function the way that I want it to as an orange bitters alongside other companion flavors. As such, I'm sorry, gotta give the win to Fee Brothers Orange. The problem with the Moroccan Orange was that it just didn't taste enough like orange. It was very much raw, organic orange peel, and that was really, really great, but it's a flavor that needs to be presented on its own. The Moroccan Orange is good, but it's too raw, and I think, I don't want to use the word unrefined, it feels unfair, but it doesn't present enough like other orange bitters to say I could put it in a cocktail that calls for orange bitters, unless specifically it is featuring it. Finally, Morning Coffee. I don't have a ton of experience with coffee bitters. The last time I used coffee bitters in a cocktail, it was in my own cocktail called a Silk Strider. When you open a bottle of bitters and you can immediately smell it in the room, you know you've got something fun to play with. I have not experimented with it today, so I don't think it's fair to fully compare it to other options on the market. The most readily available one I can think of being Australian bitters companies. Compared to that, yeah, you guys win hand over fist. This is like a really complex cup of coffee, one that you would want to sip black because adding cream or milk or sugar to it would dilute and diffuse and change those flavors, and that just isn't what you want. I think what this illustrates really more than anything else is not that McMann and Tate is bad cocktail bitters, but that they're more nuanced cocktail bitters than I think the cocktail industry is ready for. That presents an equal proportion of problem to solution, because first of all, it means that people who actually give a shit about spirits will like your stuff. I like all of these. I just think that they're more selectively usable than other bitters on the market. And as a result, the problem that results from that is I can't advise that all of these are equally usable in cocktails. The coco mole and the orange, I reach for something else. However, everything else, these three, I don't think that there's an alternative on the market that does exactly what they do. And that means that those three, at the very least, have a reason to exist, which is exactly why I went through this whole process of testing them on their own and in cocktails, because it goes to show that while these two bitters I'm saying, maybe I'd reach for something else, are not bad. They're just niche. And hopefully, McMann and Tate looks at that and goes, let's make that a fully approachable concept. So that has been our review of McMann and Tate Cocktail Bitters. Thank you guys so much for watching. I really hope you guys enjoyed it. Quick note, I want to say thank you again so much to McMann and Tate for sponsoring this video and sending me these bitters totally free. I really do appreciate it. This is an absolutely amazing opportunity. You've given me the first sponsored video I have ever made. Thank you. If you want to, you can check out McMann and Tate's website again at the link in the description down below. The QR code popping on the screen right now, generally about here. And then if I can, again, I'll do the link up in the top right corner again. YouTube is weird about that sometimes. It doesn't want you to do it twice. So maybe it's here, maybe it's not. QR code, link. My nitpicks were nitpicks. My critiques were critiques. But overall, solid 4 out of 5, I think. I would definitely say, hey, if you see these at a store near you or you see an ad for them online, if you want to try them, try them. Genuinely, I think these are really interesting ingredients to work with, and they can make a cocktail go from blah to, yeah, pretty goddamn easily. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. If you guys enjoyed, click that like button down below and subscribe to catch more episodes of Mike's Hard Reviews. I made a video a while ago saying, hey, where have I been? And that is still, what I said there is still the case now. I'm going to be in and out. I'm busy working 2 jobs and going back to school, so videos are going to be slim. But if you want to know whenever I make one, you can click that notification bell down below, and YouTube will actually tell you when I post something, as opposed to just letting you discover it 2 months too late to actually incorporate with the community. I can't stand this platform, but no one does it any better, so... oh well. Thanks again for watching. I will see you guys all in the next video. Thanks again to McMann and Tate Cocktail Company. Click the link, scan that QR code, and I'll see you guys in the next episode. Thanks for watching. Bye.